My name is Mike Vendetti. I'm a postdoctoral researcher at the University of California, Berkeley. And we are currently in the eye tracking lab here at UC Berkeley in Tolman Hall. So I grew up in Connecticut. I was born and raised there in a small Italian-American family. And so that means I had one older brother, and then it's just me and my parents and my grandparents and aunt and uncle and cousin. So very tight-knit, close, small family. My dad runs a pharmacy, so he's a pharmacist. So it's a small local business in Connecticut. And my mother is a preschool teacher, so she taught special education, either preschool and kindergartners. You know, that's kind of where I first started thinking about the idea of education and learning as being very important. When I was in high school, I had two really great teachers for a psychology class and then for the advanced placement psychology course. So that was in high school, right at the end. And after taking those courses, I really, really was interested in psychology as a field in general. So I think I knew then that I wanted to go into psychology. I think it didn't become science-oriented until I got to being a research assistant. I actually got to interact and work with EEG, so I did some neuroimaging there, and I saw the excitement, and it was really cool of just figuring out new methods to peer into the mind, and I was really, really excited about that. So I think right around that time, that's when I decided that I wanted to apply to graduate school in the hopes of becoming a professor.
So first, this thing right here, those two dots are my eyes.
There are several different models of eye trackers out there, but the one we have is called a Tobii. And what it does is it integrates the cameras, multiple cameras, into a computer monitor. And it records their eyes while they're looking at things on the screen. So it captures both left and right eye movement, which are usually going to be in very similar areas. It also captures pupil diameter, so it can get the amount of dilation, which some other people who in this lab have done stuff with dilation as a kind of proxy for cognitive effort expended while doing a working memory paradigm. It records very quickly, so this one is 120 hertz, so you can get a very, very precise measurements about where the eye is at a certain period of time, and it's useful for building up what Jesse was showing you, those kind of plots of fixations, and ultimately calculating number of fixations as well as fixation duration by just kind of summing up the fixations in certain points during a given trial to then make conclusions about if they're looking in certain locations for a certain period of time, is that going to lead to this type of strategy, which then leads to better performance or worse performance. One basic thing in a recent publication that we have was about how studies of analogical reasoning, which is what I study, so a form of relational reasoning, can be applied to the classroom. I think that's one of the biggest implications is for education. And I think that educators, there are a lot of different things. Try this, try that. And what we are trying to do is to say, this is what works. And it was also a developmental piece. So as kids age, this is what they might have issues with at certain points in their development. And doing certain things, like when you make analogical comparisons, just using simple gestures just to kind of structure the kid's attention could be the simple thing between them understanding and getting what you're trying to get across to not getting the concept. So I think one of the best implications or the easiest one I can come up with right now is to education. So learning practices and teaching practices. I really love it. So nothing was wrong with my old lab. But my old lab, it was kind of separate islands. So you had our advisor was very, very distinguished. And he just kind of gave you a lot of rope. And you could do whatever you want with it. And then by the end of your dissertation, he's going to pull on that, see what you made. Here, though, everyone is very intricately connected to one another. We study several different things. But yet we're all interested in reasoning, I'd say. That's kind of a very common denominator in this lab. And Silvia, who's my boss, she really, really cares about everyone. And not just about like just what the data look like, but what you're doing, how you feel about your project. So I think that gives a really nice overall connection that we all have in the lab. And we care about each other, both personally, but also in terms of the academic information that we're working on. Even if you don't think you can do it, I think that as long as you're interested and motivated, that the biggest predictors is just your work effort. So how much you put into it is going to determine how much you can get out of it. So don't be discouraged in the beginning. There are going to be tons of opportunities to pick up new skills, to learn new information. And I think that as long as you're really motivated to learn it, that you should go for it.